For Integrative Environmental Health Sciences and Department of Pharmacology and Toxicology welcomes you to our Environmental Health Science Series Seminar. It is my honor to introduce today's speaker, Dr. Gregory Barnes. Dr. Barnes is the inaugural permanent director of the University of Louisville Autism Center, Norton Children's Autism Center. He also holds the Spafford Ackerley Chair for Child and Adolescent Psychiatry, is a tenured professor in the departments of neurology and pediatrics, and is also a board certified in pediatric neurology and epilepsy. Importantly, Dr. Barnes serves as a developmental neurotoxicology research interest group leader in the CIEHS. Dr. Barnes' research focuses on potential genetic influences into the development of ASD and epilepsy and how these factors contribute to outcomes and potential new treatments. He has held academic appointments at Washington University School of Medicine in St. Louis, Harvard Medical School, Duke University Medical School, and the University of Kentucky College of Medicine, and Vanderbilt School of Medicine. He has authored or co-authored 114 research articles, book chapters in the fields of neurology, autism, epilepsy, and neurotoxicology. He now serves as PI or co-PI of multiple grants, including national multi-site grants, to understand the role of cannabinoid signaling and genomics in autism, understand the role of robotic treatments in autism, and train providers in autism and neurodevelopment disabilities. Without further ado, let's give a warm welcome to Dr. Gregory Barnes.
All right, thank you very much for that very warm introduction. So today I'm going off the beaten path just a little bit for our research and looking forward to the future about trying to really understand both environmental as well as microbiome influences on the biology of the developing neurovascular unit. And in particular, the developing neurovascular unit has a great impact upon GABA signaling. And so we're going to talk about that today during our talk. So as you all well know, ASD and other disorders are increasingly more common, at least for autism. There's and continues to be increased prevalence of it. And it continues to go up about 15% roughly every 2 years. Autism, like many of the neurological diseases that are in childhood, are thought to be polygenic in origin. The heritability in the studies is between 40 to 80%. But there are non-genetic influences that certainly come into play here. And I think we'll talk at least today about some of the preclinical data about that. Some of the epidemiology data suggest advanced parental age, pregnancy and birth complications, intervals between pregnancy less than 1 year, and other things such as metals. And of course, we'll also talk about the risk for the microbiome today as well. So let's just talk very briefly about the genesis of neurocircuits and developmental disorders. From a clinical standpoint, and this really goes for all developmental disorders, we know about and can test roughly for about 40% of the current mechanisms. Okay, but that leaves 60% that's actually quite unknown. Within autism, there can be up to 1,000 suspected genes. There's 100 that has pretty strong evidence, and those really fit in the categories of chromatin genes, axon guidance, and synaptic genes. But importantly, even within these genetic mechanisms, such as in Down syndrome and duplication 15q syndrome, there's evidence for altered epigenetics, which of course in the environment and the microbiome can interact with, to change the transcription particular genes that may be involved in autism, such as cell adhesion genes, ion channels, and other synaptic genes. So the pathogenesis of developmental disorders, we know that the there's a change in this, both the structure and the functional connectivity, which is shown in these two graphs here, which I won't, in these two figures on the left, which I won't go into, but it suggests both that increased curvature and surface areas of the brain, from a histology point of view, they're increased slash bigger mini columns. And in particular, there's altered GABAergic cell density as well as function of circuits. And that's really both in preclinical models as well as postmortem models. So just so that we kind of get the big picture about, you know, when people say neurocircuits, you're talking about increasing complexity of trying to complete either a behavior or a task. You've got defects that you can defects that you can see in the sort of low level basic sensory circuits. A lot of the MRI studies have been looking at sort of these secondary high ordered networks that are mediate classical things in cognition, such as working memory, language, emotional regulation, social cognition, etc. But there are many of the things that we actually test and diagnose for behaviorally are actually mediated at the sort of the meta circuit slash tertiary circuit level. And those are really complex goal-directed or flexible behaviors and cognitive tasks. For instance, if I feel thirsty and I want to take a drink, I'm going to reach out, get my cup, and then bring it to my mouth. So that's a goal-directed, very complex, many different circuits, as sort of noted here, these interaction of these secondary circuits all need to work together in order to be able to complete that task. And what's shown in the bottom, and what drives us nuts really in human clinical research, is this incredible variability that we have. As the circuits get more complex, there is more behavioral variability, but there's also more functional plasticity, which I think is a good thing for us in terms of trying to ameliorate some of these deficits in our children in particular. So much of what I've talked about has really kind of been the focus of the autism field besides treatment over the last 30 years. And really, it's only been within the last probably 2 to 5 years that there's been an increasing recognition of both non-environmental and non-genetic factors. And in particular, how does the neurovascular unit, how does that factor into that? It was noted to be some of the different things that we noted were that when we knocked out particular vascular genes in endothelial cells, it actually changed GABAergic neurogenesis and differentiation, and those mice actually had autistic behavior that was basically completely similar to what we find in classic monogenic disorders of autism, such as Fragile X. You can also, from a human level, you can actually look at one of the genetic mechanisms, the so-called pathogenic copy number variants, that's a high risk factor for autism. And you can actually see that there's an enrichment of neurovascular genes that are in those that actually correlate with CNS symptoms such as anxiety, for instance. And then, of course, there's increasing evidence both in postmortem human models as well as preclinical models about the breakdown of the neurovascular signaling impacting the blood-brain barrier. And then today, we'll talk in particular about calcium and cadmium as a exposure from the environment and doing that. So next slide. So let's talk about the biology of the blood-brain barrier. Well, as you can see here on the left, the anatomy of that is actually very complex. It consists of course, the innermost cell is the endothelial cell that has a basement membrane on it, but there are also three other components of that, the neuronal innervation, the infeed of astrocytes, and this so-called periocyte cell, which is a lining cell of most developing capillaries. And these particular cells are mediate a whole set of functions of the blood-brain barrier, some which are listed here and others which we'll talk about today, including regulation, of course, of cell blood flow, angiogenesis, and neurogenesis. And as it turns out over here on the right, the biology of basically of neurogenesis and the development of the brain and the differentiation of the blood-brain barrier is very, very, very tightly linked. And essentially, the cells are really talking to each other throughout development, starting really with the formation of the neural tube. And as you can see here in the purple, it's showing all the development of the barrier genesis, and that overlaps in the lower part here with the with both angiogenesis as well as corticogenesis and gliogenesis as well. There are two signaling systems that are particularly important in our discussion today. One which is mainly derived from developing neurons, the Wnt signaling pathway, is responsible for induction and differentiation of the blood-brain barrier. But also the maintenance of the blood-brain barrier is you need the secretion of sonic hedgehog working on the sonic hedgehog receptors on the endothelium in order to have both completing maturation as well as maintenance of the cells. All right, so our overall hypothesis for our lab is the interrupted crosstalk between the sonic hedgehog signaling and Wnt signaling promotes abnormal neurovascular signaling and autism-like behaviors. So let's first talk about environmental risk, and then we'll talk about the microbiome. Certainly heavy metals have been in the news. Of course, the increased heavy metal levels in baby food that was announced by the FDA within the last couple of years has been a great concern, as you can see here in this bullet point. Those levels are highly far above the recommended minimum requirements. And as well, there is a greatly increased percentage of obesity even in neurotypical children since the 1970s. And in fact, if you look at the prevalence of obesity and being overweight and development disorders such as autism, it's really significantly increased. And part of that is due to the fact that they love their carbohydrates and fats. There are many other things that might be going on here, including the microbiome, which might contribute towards that. So basically by adulthood, almost 100% of / 18 years of age, almost 100% self-report that they're overweight. So a significant problem. All right. Our hypothesis going into this work was really is to model whether whole life low dose cadmium exposure and postnatal high fat diets are in fact impact factors, are environmental factors which impact Wnt signaling and downstream biological processes and behaviors in ASD. There's both, of course, evidence in humans as well as evidence in rodents that exposure to cadmium is either linked to ASD and also, of course, affects cognition and behavior that is found in ASD, as well as some of the neurotransmitter systems in ASD, such as dopamine, which is central to a lot of the different behaviors and cognition impacted and developmental disorders in general, but particularly ASD. All right. So this is just to remind us the intertwining of these two signaling pathways. Over on the right, you can see that both the sonic hedgehog on the left part of the figure and the wind signaling pathway on the other side of the figure, they have crosstalk between each other, and they're really responsible for differentiation, the pro-survival repair, the expression of tight junction proteins, and normal angiogenesis. But you can also demonstrate, difficulties with inflammation, certainly reactive oxygen species, et cetera, if you see dysregulation of these particular pathways, and we'll talk about that. All right, so the overview of our animal model, and this has been in collaboration with both Jun Kai as well as Liu Kai from the Pediatric Research Institute. In Euro, before there is conception, there's a change to the normal diet and cadmium in the water. And you have the exposure up until the time of conception. And then subsequently, you are going ahead and exposing them to either 5 parts per million or 0.5 parts per million, as well as the high fat diet post-wean. And when we look at these animals and ask where the cadmium is in the brain, what we find is that there is cadmium that accumulates in the cortex, the hippocampus, and the cerebellum, so three structures that are important and circuits that are important to ASD. And in particular, there's the highest levels both either with the normal diet or the high-fat diet in the cerebellum, which is intriguing to us, but it's something that we need to look at a bit further, as you'll see in just a second. So we did find that there is oxidation of the DNA in the brains exposed to cadmium and/or the high-fat diet. Both the 5 parts per million and high-fat diet can induce oxidation in the cortex and the dendrite gyrus. And the high-fat diet seems to, as we can see in the figure there all the way to the right, seems to enhance the oxidation. We really didn't see much in the cerebellum, despite the fact that we had higher dosing. But this, of course, was at one specific time point, so we need to look at several different time points to see. Secondly, we did look at whether there is glial activation. And in fact, both the high-fat diet and the cadmium can activate both microglia and astrocytes in the cortex and the dentate gyrus. Again, at the particular time point we looked at, we didn't see it in the cerebellum. The high-fat diet, of course, enhanced that cadmium effect. And we didn't see any sort of glial activation at a lower concentration, 0.5 parts per million of cadmium. We did look in the offspring at the blood-brain barrier integrity, and this is injecting fluorescent albumin. And as you can see there in the figure, there is disruption of the blood-brain barrier and the cortex, either with cadmium, 5 parts per million, or the high-fat diet. But it's really more severe in those that are exposed to both. And as you would kind of expect with an impact of the high-fat diet and some of these markers of neuroinflammation, there was cadmium-dependent increased messenger RNA expression of certain cytokines, including TNF-alpha and interleukin-10 in the cortex, either exposed to cadmium. If we're seeing all this type of neuroinflammation, are we seeing impacts on the when beta catenin signaling pathway. Now, the reason why that we're so interested in that pathway, besides all of the knockouts that show autistic-like behaviors, is that many of these different components of the Wnt signaling system have genetic mutations, either with hyperactivation or hypoactivation in genetics studies, and there's some of the strongest autism genes in all of the genetic studies. And the other thing that's kind of interesting is that of all of the known autism genes that have been seen in genetic studies, about 40% of them you can link in one way or the other to the Wnt signaling system. So do we see changes/activation of the Wnt signaling pathway in this preclinical cadmium/obesity model? All right. So first off, we took a look at some of the messenger RNA of some of the inhibitors of the Wnt activation. And we saw some decreases and the messenger RNA when we expose them to cadmium, and the high-fat diet did have an impact upon that, with decreasing the inhibitors even more. Now, we also saw that there was some decrease in both beta-catenin and GSK3-beta messenger RNA, but mainly only for the diet. But very interestingly, when we did immunoblots, we saw cadmium-induced accumulation, and really in a dose-dependent manner, of both the activated beta-catenin and the phosphorylation of GS3K-beta. So concluding from this part of the talk, let me check my time here. Should be okay, but yeah, 11:26. So to summarize this part, whole life low-dose cadmium exposure and post-weaning high-fat diet causes DNA oxidative stress, glial activation, as one would expect with an inflammatory response, and apparent evidence that there's impairment of the blood-brain barrier and the cortex of offspring. Post-weaning, the high-fat diet seems to exacerbate some of these effects. And what was very interesting, and I didn't show the data today because I really need to talk about the microbiome in this talk, mice fed cadmium and the high-fat diet do show ASD-relevant behavioral defects, such as social defects, defects in repetitive behaviors, and defect in open field testing. And at least we have some preliminary evidence right now that the Wnt signaling system is disturbed in mice fed cadmium in the high fat diet in this particular model. So we have evidence, at least in this preclinical model, that exposure to some non-genetic factors, including obesity or metals, can impact the developing brain, at least of rodents anyways. But, you know, there has been a lot of interest in non-genetic factors, such as microbiome and autism and other developmental disorders. Part of that is driven by the fact that over 80% of patients, say with autism, have some sort of GI symptoms of some sort. And that's something that's always a part of your discussion clinically. And so the parents have always been very interested, as well as obviously the physicians who treat autism have been very interested in the microbiome question. So, parental report that when they've treated their kids with either prebiotics, probiotics, special diets, or my favorite one is antibiotic treatment. I have many parents that say, you know, I love it when my kid gets sick and gets treated with antibiotics because his autism symptoms go away. So it's really an interesting observation from the parents. And so, you know, there is an overall great interest in dysbiosis caused by, you know, poor diet, unhealthy lifestyle, stress, et cetera, et cetera. And, you know, we're talking about the so-called gut-brain axis that is mediated by a number of different systems, including the autonomic / vagus nerve system, the enteric nervous system itself, the hypothalamic / pituitary axis, and including, you know, we'll talk about today, bacterial metabolites, neurotransmitters, and cytokines. And those are all thought to be related to, you know, a whole host of neurological and psychiatric disorders, and including autism spectrum disorders. And so there's really a lot of interest in looking at these treatments, which include, both probiotics as well as fecal microbiota transplantation. Now, some of these observations and what's been driving this has been our observations from germ-free mice. Germ-free mouse, we'll talk about it in a second, and it has a lot of different problems that look very similar to different neurological disorders. If you look in humans, in the top part of the figure here, you really have a so-called dysbiosis, and you can see changes in the microbiome that are associated with a whole host of both neurological and psychiatric disease. You can also take microbiota from a human donor and then transplant it in a healthy recipient mouse who's have their microbiota removed, say, by antibiotic treatment. And you can cause certainly symptoms that are associated with, you know, typical models of schizophrenia, ASD, depression, anxiety. And then as well, you can take a mouse that has a genetic defect, for instance, of one of these neurological disorders. You can take the microbiota from a healthy donor, give it to the mouse that's got neurological disease, and then make it more like the wild type mouse again. So a lot of these different transplant techniques suggest, at least in preclinical models, that there may be something to understanding microbiome biology and neurological disorders. So germ-free mice, as I said, they have altered behavior, for instance. They have reduced anxiety, they have learning and memory impairments. And importantly, they have impairments in social behavior, they have increased stereotypic or repetitive behaviors and locomotor behaviors, and these behaviors really are pretty much indistinguishable from the behaviors that you would see in a monogenic mouse disorder, mouse such as the Fragile X mouse. There's also a altered stress responsivity from changes in the hypothalamus and pituitary axis and decrease in the glucocorticoid signaling. Importantly, there are changes that are neurochemical changes and that you oftentimes see in many of these disorders, but particularly in ASD, which include altered serotonergic, glutamatergic, and GABAergic neurotransmission. And then finally, you have these cellular changes, which include increased blood-brain barrier permeability, increased neural survival. Just to remind you, you know, in autism, a lot of the children are macrocephalic, and there's between 20 to 40% more neurons at certain stages of life, particularly early in life, that have been found in postmortem specimens. Altered microglia. Homeostasis and maturity, and changes in the pyramidal cells. And they're all associated with these different disorders listed here at the bottom. Now, as you well know, there have been clinical trials that have been done in autism and the microbiome. You know, it's sort of mixed so far, but it's interesting. There have been four double-blind trials with probiotics that either single species, bacterial species, or a mix of up to four species. And they basically have been mostly in children. Some teenagers have been included with at least one documented GI symptom. Okay. And the duration has been anywhere from 3 weeks to 3 months. Those that have been double blind with probiotics did not show any significant differences in behaviors or symptoms measured for the randomized trials. There was one randomized trial that actually combined probiotics with one of the prosocial peptide hormones called oxytocin, and we'll talk about oxytocin plays one of the central roles in social behaviors in autism. And they actually found some roughly mild improvements on the autism behavioral checklist and in the social cognition subscore of the social responsiveness scale. So some impact there, a small study published in 2021. There have been two fecal microbiota transplants. They've been open label trials only, so they have all of the objections of open label trials. 40 to 60 children, again, wide age range, wide duration of the transplant, anywhere from 4 weeks to 10 weeks, followed by a week follow up. At least in these open label trials, you know, with all the caveats therein, they did see decreases in scores in the autism behavioral checklist and the social responsiveness scale. The decreases in the scores were, you know, mild to moderate. So, you know, clinically significant, yes, amelioration probably, but did it completely cause things to go away? No, not at all. Okay. So that's what's been, that is the work from the clinical standpoint. You know, there are a number of different factors that, of course, affect gut microbiota, which include, you know, diets, as we've talked about here. There's probably, you know, age that definitely may play in a component, and certainly medicines, antibiotics, for instance. We won't even talk about host genetic factors today, but, host factors and stress and even mode of delivery during the neonatal period can all have an impact upon the microbiota with subsequent changes in neurodevelopment. So let's talk a little bit about, kind of what the microbiome does and development. So first off, in the top figure here, this is a figure from a paper that talks about the different sorts of factors that are produced by microbiota that impact brain development. As you can see there on the top, there is both the cytokines that are influenced by microbiota, as well as these SCFAs, or short-chain fatty acids. Both of those are involved in the normal maturity, as well as the activation under pathological conditions of microglia, which microglia have a central role in the development of synapses and the sculpting of synaptic circuitry. And as well, these microbiota, and you can see some of the bacterial species listed on the bottom, produce these neuroactive molecules, including glutamate, GABA, dopamine, norepinephrine, serotonin, histamine, and acetylcholine. It influences either the enteric nerves, which then influence the vagus nerve through the medulla up into the nucleus tractus solitarius, which projects to the whole cortex, or it gets into the blood. And there are certain mechanisms that we'll talk about today as some of these neurochemicals that are active in the blood as well. We'll talk about those today. So one of the very first interesting things when I was thinking about this was, genetic systems that we can take advantage of to really ask about what signaling systems are involved and the impact of the microbiome. And one of those is, of course, is developing a zebrafish. And it turns out that if you expose developing zebrafish they're either germ-free, or you expose them to an adult microbiome from a mature zebrafish, you have impact of actually only about 300 some odd genes, which includes a lot of genes involved in neuronal differentiation and neuronal maintenance. And in particular, there is about 75 genes of the Wnt signaling pathway that are impacted. So really quite interesting, of course. We've talked about the impact of the Wnt signaling pathway on the development of the blood-brain barrier. And so that was quite an interesting finding, and there's much more. If you take neuroactive metabolites from the adult gut of zebrafish, basically impact the same genes and the 75 Wnt signaling genes as noted in the pathway there in E, and I realize that you can't see it there very well. These whatever neuroactive metabolites that these bacteria are producing impact when the expression of the Wnt signaling pathway gene. So really, really quite interesting. Very recent, 2022. Now, how do we connect that to some of the interesting observations that we have seen with regard to the brain itself, and that is neuroinflammation? Well, it turns out that there is a signaling pathway that's called the RAGE pathway. RAGE stands for Receptor for Advanced Glycation End Products. These are non-enzymatic products of glycation, both of proteins and lipids. And as you can see there on the top right, it activates signaling pathways that, J and K, MAP kinase, the JAK-STAT pathways, these are all pathways, of course, that we recognize from inflammatory processes. And this receptor is certainly known to influence cell migration, which is certainly an important part of neuroinflammation. It influences stress responses. And importantly, it influences both pro and anti-inflammatory pathways. This particular receptor, which I think is really interesting, it's specific to mammals. You don't really see it in lower animals. And its highest expression by far is in the cerebral endothelial vascular cells. So really, really quite interesting. Besides the non-enzymatic glycation products, it binds to some pretty interesting ligands. And we'll talk about at least some of these today. Of course, the one that you probably recognize the most are the oligomers, the amyloid beta peptide. And there's a whole story there with regard to that, but I won't be going into that because that's the Alzheimer's field. But nonetheless, let's look at some of these molecules with regard to development. So first off, the RAGE signaling pathway seems to mediate some normal brain development in a number of different ways. First off, really quite interestingly, the RAGE knockout mouse is autistic. And there are a lot of autistic-like behaviors that you see in that mouse. The RAGE receptor also does mediate, and this is an increasing area of neurobiology, but it does mediate neuron differentiation and neuron growth. There are just a couple of papers there, but it certainly does seem to do that. And the RAGE receptor also seems to mediate pro-social behaviors via two different antigens in the or receptors in the brain, the CD37 receptor and the CD157 receptor. Both of those are mediate the release of oxytocin from oxytocin releasing neurons. I'm not going to try to say the oxytocinergic, whatever. So anyways, well, in both of these knockout mice for CD37 and CD157 have autistic-like behaviors, so that's what we'll talk about. Now, this is a slide just to illustrate the pathway. Either CD38 and or C157, they are enzymes that activate the cyclic ADP ribose signaling, and of course through that signaling it binds to its receptor on the endoplasmic reticulum and releases calcium, and as a result activates CAM kinase 2. Shown there in the middle, one of the things that does promote as a result is promotes oxytocin release. And overall on the right, this figure is just meant to show us the different sorts of behavioral defects that you see in these signaling pathways for CD38 and C157. So hyperactivity, social problems, social avoidance, emotional flexibility. So all of these things, of course, are things that you see in autistic individuals. And you can rescue a lot of these defects by intraperitoneal oxytocin administration of mice. And there also have been, clinical trials in humans administering the nasal oxytocin or enteral oxytocin. And what's shown there in the middle is that the oxytocin that's actually in the blood is actually bound by the RAGE receptor and actually uptake into the brain to be able to bind to specific receptors in the brain. So Very interesting pathway. Now, this is talking about the rage knockout mouse itself. Now, the rage knockout mouse, it also has abnormal maternal behaviors. And the idea here is that in wild type mice, of course, there is maternal suckling, and the breast milk contains a fair amount of oxytocin that's absorbed in the intestine, and then it is released by, it's absorbed by the rage receptor, and then it's again taken out of the blood by the rage receptor, transported across the blood-brain barrier, and released into the brain itself. The knockout mice, of course, the moms don't have a deficient maternal behavior, as well as other sorts of asocial behaviors. If you look at the offspring, the oxytocin promotes the so-called USV, which are ultrasonic vocalizations that pups give off to call their mothers. You don't see that in the pups who are the offsprings of knockout animals. So all of these processes are both oxytocin dependent and, of course, rage receptor dependent. All right, so why is this peptide important? Well, this is just an example of one of the behaviors. In the developing and brain, there is a nucleus that's subcortical. It's called the nucleus accumbens. It is responsible for mediating social reward. And as it turns out, if you interfere with either the oxytocin signaling or the serotonin signaling in the nucleus accumbens through their receptors, either the oxytocin receptor or the 5-HT1B receptor, you actually induce so-called presynaptic long-term depression. And that is responsible for mediating social reward. And if you block that signaling, then you have deficient social reward behavior. And this is really characteristic of what oxytocin does. Oxytocin usually is a peptide that binds to a receptor. And then there's another neurotransmitter system that binds to the presynaptic terminal as well, and it mediates very specific and usually social behaviors in the brain. Now, one of the things that's really interesting about this whole story is that there's a fair amount of literature on how the rage receptor impacts wind signaling. This particular paper that I show here is showing that receptor activation disrupts the wind signaling in the spinal cord neurons. But there is a whole story, really, in preclinical models in both diabetes as well as aging. The idea is, of course, here that as one ages or has diabetes, there is an increased development and formation of these advanced glycation products. So as a result, it activates the rage receptor on the cerebral endothelial cells. It promotes both increased blood-brain permeability as well as infiltration of leukocytes or macrophages to mediate neuroinflammation of the brain through either neurons, activated microglia, or abnormal astrocytes. So there certainly is a fair amount of literature on the interaction between these two pathways. So now what's quite interesting is that if you look at the rage signaling pathway and its ligands, In children with autism, what you find is that there is decreased amount of oxytocin, which would go with abnormalities in social behaviors. And there's also an increase in a couple of different ligands here, which include the S100 ligand and the HMGB1 ligand. Okay, I'm going to have to finish up here. The next couple of studies basically want to quote are showing that, you know, if you expose developing rodents to higher levels of either S100, for instance, you actually alter synaptic levels of the shank protein and excitatory synapses in a metal-dependent, size zinc-dependent manner. And the high exposure leads to reduced levels. And on a behavioral level, you see hyperactivity, increased stereotypic and abnormal social behaviors, and cognitive impairment. We see the same thing actually in terms of in inhibition in human neural stem cells. And I just wanted to show this paper as very briefly. And then the final thing is, well, you know, if this is all true, Greg, then what does the gut microbiota have to do with this? Well, it turns out that if you take microbiota from old rats or old mice, and then you transplant it into young mice, you actually see a number of very interesting things. Number one, you see increased expression and activation of the RAGE receptor with increased reactive oxygen species, pro-inflammatory cytokines, both in the hippocampus and the medial prefrontal cortex, two areas that are associated with autism. Along with that, if you do look via functional MRI, you see decreased functional connectivity, which is bullet point two there. You see a reduced expression of synaptic plasticity proteins, okay? And then, and that goes with, you see alterations in synaptic structure and protein actually decrease after the fecal microbiota transplant. And then finally, you see impairment of cognition. And this will be my final slide. Now, well, if that is true, then, you know, is there evidence that the microbiota actually impact GABA signaling, for instance, which is one of the downstream important neuronal systems that is in cerebral endothelial cells? And the answer to that is probably, okay? There's a couple of different papers right now that look at the role of one particular type of bacteria, so-called lactobacillus. And in this paper here, which was published in 2021, this shows the impact of lactobacillus both in fruit flies and in rodent models. And what you see is you see, and importantly, you see increased GABA-A and GABA-B receptor expression, which is what I've shown over there on the right side with the Western blots, and it quantifies and statistically significant off of the blots. There's also an increase in the serotonin receptors, the 5-HT1A receptor, which is a receptor that's actually expressed on GABAergic interneurons. The impact of that is increased sleep duration, for instance, in Drosophila, at least how you can measure sleep in Drosophila. So I will have to say that. But these are the same sorts of methods, for instance, that they use for measuring things such as the clock gene and the clock pathway. In rodents, what you see is you see increased delta and theta waves during non-REM sleep. Okay, and these are the same sorts of waves that we see increase in response to, say, benzodiazepines, for instance, that, of course, lead to increased sleep. And it led to about a third of an increase in the sleep duration in the rodents which parallels that you see in fruit flies. So let's sum up the impact here. We do previously certainly have data that, and we talked about today that, gene mutations, metals, and other non-genetic factors such as the microbiome and RAGE signaling certainly can impact the cells in the blood, including leukocytes and neutrophils. We do have some evidence in bullet point two that there is alteration in GABA beta receptor signaling. And we also have some evidence in three that there's actually degranulation of these neutrophils that may actually cleave off the tail of some of the GABA receptor, the GABA B receptor, which might also be transcription reactive. That certainly does interact with the Wnt signaling pathway, and we certainly have data for alterations of that. And as a result, in some way that we don't quite understand yet, we certainly see that the signals from the damaged endothelial cells and infiltrating immune cells activate astrocytes and microglia. You have production of the pro-inflammatory cytokines. You also have the developing neuron that is healthy going into a more diseased neuron through some of the neurovascular signaling pathways that we have labeled there, which includes some of the semaphorin signaling. And then as a result, in the developing brain, at least, you get an abnormal migration of neural cells. You get abnormal axon targeting with the formation of abnormal nerve circuits and then the expression of autistic-like behaviors, and at least in the preclinical models. So we're looking forward to our next steps, which will be in the microbiome area. And particularly, we're very interested in, although there's little data to look at that in metals, microbiome, and brain development, but we look forward to looking at that in the future here in the next year or two. So there's a lot of people to thank that had that either supplied evidence/data/work for this particular talk. Thank you to all of my collaborators at the Pediatric Research Institute, including both Drs. Kai as well as Dr. Gazelle and Rekha, who's sitting over there. I do want to point out that there are two pediatric neurology residents who are going to be intimately involved in the project going forward. One is CJ Saddle, and the other one is going to be a new faculty member at the Autism Center, whose name is Jamie Shu. And they were really key in a lot of some of the literature that we have went over in the last half of our talk. Want to thank both Dr. Rene as well as Barati and from U of L Nephrology. The microbiome work, of course, is going to be in collaboration with Sharish Barve and Scott Whittemore, who is very interested in getting